Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Backstage with Fred Cooper. I tonight have one of the fellows who run a very large organization here in Orange County. He is the illustrious Sir Richard O. Hughes, the potentate of the Albacal Shrine Temple of Anaheim. Dick, I'm glad to have you here tonight.
Fred, it's great to be here, and I'm proud to be able to talk to you and discuss what us Shriners do. I know there's been a lot of people curious. We're a fun-loving bunch, but we have a serious side, and I'm glad to be here and explain to you what we do.
I'm glad, because the only thing I know about Shriners is that they have a big party all the time. That's not true, though.
That's not exactly true. We play hard, and we work hard.
Mm-hmm.
The reason we work hard is our philanthropy for our Shriners Hospital friend. Yes, we do play. We have parades we're in.
Mm-hmm.
We have a lot of fun with that.
Mm-hmm.
But we, in having our fun, makes us work real hard for our hospitals. And I hope I'm going to have time to be able to explain the number of hospitals we have.
Good, good. Let's talk about the parades a little bit. Now, I remember we used to see the clowns, the Shrine clowns, all the time. Where are these fellows all the time? Where do they put their little motorcycles and that great big drum that they haul around and things
like
that?
Our temple, located in Anaheim, we have 14 units that we parade with, consisting of clowns, mini cars, mini bikes, large bikes, tin Lizzies, which are replicas of Model T-Fords. We have all of these. We have clowns, yes, and we have a patrol, we have a Legion of Honor, and we're proud to represent Albacal and get out there with the public and sometime get to them what we actually do. It's a lot of fun for in the parades, but we work hard to support our philanthropy, and I know you know what that is.
Oh, yes, very much so. Now, how about the ladies that, now, your wives, this is obviously a very involved thing. It takes a lot of your time if you're a Shriner. Well, how about the wives? What do they do? Do they have another organization that is involved in this type of work?
Our wives, Fred, are very much a part of our hospital. They're very much a part of our temple. We're proud of our ladies, and we include them in everything we do.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, the ladies work hard. In fact, we have one organization that's called the Ladies Oriental Shrine of America that the ladies get involved in. And last year, the ladies alone gave over $1 million to the hospital.
Wow.
That includes, parties they have, and the money they make at these parties, and the fun they've had. This supports our hospitals. Our ladies right now, I understand, well, my lady was a past Grand High Priestess of the Ladies Oriental Shrine in 1989 and 90. To make money for our temple, she traveled 102,000 miles in 10 months by airline.
Really?
In United States, Alaska, Canada, and Hawaii, supporting our hospitals, gaining money for our hospitals, and having dinners for our hospitals. The ladies are very much involved.
True dedication.
That's right. It's true dedication. So you can see they haven't complained too much about the time we've given in and been away from home. You wonder
as long
why.
As you take them with you.
is true.
Tell us about the fez. Now, and tell me what the word potentate means. Tell me what the sword is, because I'm...
All right. The word potentate is the gentleman or the title given to the man that is in charge of Albacal Temple in Anaheim this year. We have 191 shrine temples in America, North America, and each temple...
Wait, how many?
191.
191.
Right, and the only... And each one has a potentate, so I'm in charge of our Albacal.
How many smaller... Like, we have the Leisure World Shrine Club. How many of these little groups are under you?
We have 37.
37.
Right, in my jurisdiction.
How many times a year do you get together?
We
all
travel.
Together?
We visit each one of our clubs or units, like our Leisure World here.
Mm-hmm.
We're over at Leisure World in Seal Beach here 4 times a year.
Oh, yeah?
We come to their club every year, 4 times a year. We're at their installation. We're at their meetings. They're very good supporters of our hospital.
Okay.
The Fez. Okay.
The Fez.
I know you're curious about that.
You bet I am. I want one.
Let's get into that for you.
Okay.
The Fez goes way back. Mm-hmm. I think the earliest that I can find out where the Fez came into existence, Fred, was about, let's say this, it was made, the best we can find out, the reason it's called a Fez, because it was made in Fez, Morocco. Now, the best thing we can come up with, a historian can come up with the date, is about A.D. 890.
Oh,
A.D.
Wow.
890, when it was really coming out into existence, and I think if you've ever seen Arabian Nights,
mm-hmm.
that is the first time that it's really come out into existence. So from that date on, we have accepted this as our emblem.
Mm-hmm.
And this just merely shows the temple.
Mm, okay. Mm-hmm.
This shows an emblem. It's been adopted. There could be a lot of reasons for this. This goes back into history, Fred, that how do we know where some of these things originate? My title is here.
Mm-hmm. Now, the other people who have titles, those are also on their cap?
There's six other elected officers in the divan. Elected.
In the divan.
That's the divan. That's the gentleman that's part of the family that belong to the temple, and they run the temple.
Okay.
Now, in addition to six other elected officers, I have appointed officers I appointed for the year, probably 35
mm-hmm.
that I have appointed for the year.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Some of those only last for a year during my reign. The potentate coming up next will have his own and his own people. He would like to help him run the temple for the year. That's what it boils down to.
So you get 1 year.
I get one year, yes. I will be through in my reign in January the 4th, 1997.
Okay.
And it's been a precious, great year. I've enjoyed every bit of it.
I bet it has been fun getting to meet all these people. Do you eat a lot doing this?
Well, let's
you must
say
go
this.
To an awful lot of dinners, I'm telling you.
When you're out about three or four nights a week.
Oh, wow.
As a little pun, if I may make one, I have found out there's lots of ways to cook chicken breast. I want to tell you.
There's good and bad.
And there's good, and I want to tell you, they can take care of roast beef in their fashion, too. They can handle that real easy.
I'll bet.
Sometimes they have the gravy that goes, but the gravy should have been left out.
I understand you have a tape that you would like to show us about some of the hospitals.
We do have, Fred, and I think the tape that we're going to show you
mm-hmm.
will show you some of the things we do. I will explain a little more of it later, if I may.
Okay.
But let's look at the tape here and just see what's going on, okay?
Okay. Thank you very much.
All right.
Just a moment.
We'll be right back.
Each year, Shriners Hospitals for Crippled Children provide free medical care to thousands of young people. This is the story of how Shriners helped one young man fulfill his dreams of gold. September 1992. The eyes of the world are no longer focused on the city of Barcelona. Another Olympic competition has ended. But soon, this city will play host once again to the world's greatest athletes. When the Olympic flame burns here again, it will be in recognition of athletes like Tony Volpentest, athletes who have overcome incredible odds to earn the right to compete among the world's best. The youngest of six children, Tony Volpentest was born without hands or feet. For his parents, the question of what the future held for a handicapped child was frightening.
The first questions I asked the pediatrician was, will he be able to walk and can he go to a public school?
My initial feeling was that I hoped something internally was wrong and maybe he'd die. Something happened about that time in my mind. It just snapped around the other way, and I wanted to have him. I mean, I wanted him worse than the other five.
Doctors told Tony's parents he might face a life of limited mobility and that he might never walk. His parents will always remember the day Tony proved the doctors wrong.
And I thought, oh, this is exciting. This is absolutely incredible. His dad's going to be so surprised and everything. So I got on the phone and called him up and I said, honey, there's a miracle and I'm living right.
That miracle set the tone for Tony's early years. His parents learned to treat him like any other child, and Tony discovered there was little he couldn't accomplish if he was just given a chance to try.
I just keep an open mind, and from the start, nobody ever told me that I couldn't do anything. So I never had that barrier in my mind.
There's so many things that he does that you would think he could never do. It allows us to open our minds enough to say, we can't tell Tony he can't do it because we haven't seen him try it yet.
In 1985, Tony was accepted as a patient at Shriners Hospital for Crippled Children in Portland, Oregon. Though he and his family didn't know it at the time, his association with Shriners would literally change his life.
When we first took Tony to the Shriners Hospital down there, we were going on one of the elevators. And I turned around, and right behind me on the wall was a collage of a young girl that had been a patient there. And it showed her picture in the middle, and then it showed her on her horse, and it showed her doing her gymnastics, and it showed a couple of the ribbons that she had gotten for her horseback riding. And I looked at that and I thought, what an inspiration. For the parents as well as the children in the hospital to know that these kids can achieve.
Growing up, Tony had a love for sports. Over the years, he always figured out a way to participate in the activities that interested him. From the start, the staff at Shriners Hospital was impressed with Tony's accomplishments and supportive of his goals.
Nothing seems to stop him. He's ready to get involved in any activity. Nothing limits him.
Okay, in your blocks.
In 1988, Tony set his sights on his ultimate physical challenge. Though he had never participated in track, he was determined to compete as a sprinter in Barcelona, Spain at the 1992 Paralympic Games, the equivalent of the Olympics for the best physically disabled athletes in the world.
Well, at first it was just one of those things, I'll go out and try it and see how it works. And everything seemed to click so smoothly that got to the point where I thought, I really do have a shot at this if I work hard and put everything into it.
Tony began participating at a junior level in competitions for disabled athletes and was unbeatable. His performances were impressive, but he knew his times would need to be faster if he was to be competitive at a world-class level. So Shriners Hospital came to his aid once again, this time by fitting him with the latest in high-tech prostheses designed specifically for athletes.
These people listen to the patients. They give them the best that money can buy, and they're working with them. If the patient shows an interest in wanting to get better, then the Shriners are right there to help them.
So you're going to be running more on your toes,
right?
Since most other people can move their ankle, which you're not able to do.
Well, without them, I wouldn't be doing any of this. They've done a tremendous amount, and above and beyond that, they've always been so nice. A lot of people that work in hospitals sometimes lose sight of what they're there for, and at the Shriners, they're always they look at it more as a service rather than a job, and they really take it seriously, and they really try to show the kids that they care, and they go out of their way to do that.
The special prostheses provided by Shriners Hospital made a remarkable difference in Tony's performances. Now, he was not only winning disabled competitions, he was even competitive against able-bodied sprinters.
He's definitely a great sprinter, there's no doubt about it, but the technology is what's held him back. With these new feet, he's right in the thick of the competition. World class, obviously.
Soon, Tony decided it was time to move up to the big leagues, to take on the senior competitors who stood between him and a chance for Paralympic gold. Tony would now be competing against the world's best, like
like Paralympic champion and world record holder Dennis Oehler, the world's fastest leg amputee. Oehler had never been beaten in competition.
He's a very interesting person. He's a great athlete, and he's given me a lot of advice and a lot of support throughout the years, even though he's known that I've been coming up and chopping on his times.
Tony lost to Oehler in his first senior competition in 1990. But the next year, at an exhibition match at Randall's Island in New York, Tony turned the tables on the champion, defeating him and setting a new U.S. record in the 100-meter dash.
Well, first of all, it was unexpected. I didn't think I was going to beat him the first time I did. And I was actually a hundredth of a second off his world record. And the combination of the two just kind of blew my mind.
During the months leading up to the Paralympic Games, Tony spent a great deal of time at Shriners Hospital in Portland. There, the staff worked with him to improve the prostheses he used in competition. But word of Tony's accomplishments made him more than a patient at Shriners. He became an inspiration to others.
He's been willing to help with other patients at times when they're in need of some counseling. Maybe there's a new amputee or someone who's having some challenges. He'll come and talk with them and listen to them, and they'll, you know, a lot of people have, it has helped them to know that there's more to life, you know, than where they're at the moment.
It's kind of your victories over there are going to be all of our victories. I hope you know that you've got 5,700 Shrine kids running with you.
Yes.
And hoping that you win it for all of us.
I'm just happy that I've been a part of the Shrine system, and hope I can contribute someday to help other children.
You have already.
They have come from every corner of the world. More than 3,000 representatives from 85 countries. The athletes of the 9th Paralympic Games. Though tragedy has dramatically changed the lives of some, and others like Tony Volpentest have spent a lifetime living with a disability, they are not to be pitied. These are athletes of the highest caliber, with performances rivaling those of the Olympians themselves.
I'm an athlete, so it's just a thrill to me to be competing, and it doesn't really matter to me where it is or who it's with.
Paralympic Games give Tony and the other competitors an opportunity to change attitudes, to show the world that a physical challenge doesn't stop a person from pursuing their dreams. In the United States, few people attend disabled sporting events. But here in the Olympic Stadium, Tony will be competing in front of more than 55,000 spectators. Among them, the King and Queen of Spain. It's an experience he'll never forget.
And I heard the crowd, and all of a sudden, it just kind of hit me. I thought, oh, that, you know, this is big. This is bigger than anything I've ever done.
Tony's years of hard work will finally be put to the test. In the 100-meter dash, he'll be taking on the fastest amputees in the world, among them Dennis Oehler, who holds the world record with a time of 11.73 seconds. That's less than 2 seconds slower than able-bodied world record holder Carl Lewis. This will be Tony's greatest challenge. The winning time is 11.63 seconds, a new world record. It's a proud moment for Tony and his family.
11.63 seconds.
You know, if it hadn't been for Shriners, just none of this would have happened. They've had faith in him. They've seen something in him that maybe we didn't even see.
He set his goal 4 years ago.
Yeah.
And the Barcelona picture hung in his room for 3.5 years.
I couldn't say anything. I broke up.
But Tony's victory isn't his only memorable experience on this day. After the race, he meets his family outside the stadium and is surprised to find that he is greeted by the people of Spain as a true hero.
There was a respect that was in their faces when they were looking at Tony. And I remember there was one lady there, maybe in her 70s or so, who was shaking and half crying. And she went up and touched him. And then he hugged her. And that was nice.
That really hit something in my heart, and it was one of the most special moments of the whole games for me.
It seems that it will be difficult for Tony to top his performance from the first day of competition. But today, in the semifinals for the 200 meter, he surprises even himself.
In the preliminaries, the last 15 meters, I slowed down because I wanted to reserve some for the finals. Came across the line and looked up at the clock, and I couldn't believe it.
23.97 seconds.
Without even trying, Tony has managed to set a new world record. As evening comes, Tony awaits his most important event, the 200-meter final. If he can win this race, he will claim the title of the fastest amputee in the world. The stadium is sold out. Thousands are turned away at the gates. It will be an ideal setting for Tony's greatest moment.
It's nice to perform in front of a crowd. The more and more I do it, the more and more I like to do it. It's just an incredible feeling.
Tony Volpentest is living his dream, a dream that could never have been possible without the support of Shriners Hospitals.
A friend back home made a necklace for me that I wore each of my races. What I did when I put that necklace on is I had that necklace represent all of the children and all of the help and all the support that everybody has given me.
With years of hard work and the support of Shriners Hospitals, Tony Volpentest has become the fastest amputee sprinter in the world. His world record times are just heartbeats away from the records of Olympic champions. But Tony's medals and titles are not his greatest triumph. It's the fact that he has shown those who face challenges in life that if you believe in yourself, anything is possible.
You know, someone asked me about a year ago, why do you cry when Tony runs? I think that one of the reasons I cry, certainly I'm proud of what he's doing and the way he's doing it. But I think beyond that, the reason I cry when I see that is because he's breaking some of the stereotypes that I had in my own mind about disabled people.
I just like to show people that we can do what they can do. Maybe in a different way, but we can still do it.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, and that was a very fascinating tape. Tell us a little bit more about the other projects that the Shrine has around, besides hospitals.
I hope. Well, I would like to talk just a little more about the hospital,
okay.
If I may, and give additional information.
Good.
A lot of people don't know, and I hope your audience, after viewing this tape, will have a great, great understanding of why we're there. We have, at the present time, mm-hmm. 22 hospitals, United States, mm-hmm. one in Mexico, one in Hawaii. Mm-hmm. 19 of those hospitals are for orthopedic patients, 3 of them are burn patients, and at the present time, our budget this year, $419 million.
Holy moly.
Now, I'm going to state this, that we accept no money from insurance companies. We accept no money from anybody. The patients do not pay. The patients' parents do not pay. This is strictly done by the Shriners. At the present time, we have 610,000 Shriners in our 191 temples.
Wow.
This is, we support this. The interest off of our, what we call, endowment, wills, and gifts.
Mm-hmm.
We accept gifts from outsiders, sure.
Mm-hmm.
Tremendous amount of people
mm-hmm.
that help our kids. This supports our hospital.
Mm-hmm.
My dues a year, out of my dues, $5 goes towards that hospital. And that $5 entitles me, if you see a kid that's burned, their folks can't afford it, we don't care if they can or can't. If we can help the kid, if it's an orthopedic situation, all I do, Fred, is sign my name at the bottom of an application that kid's put into a hospital and he's to be taken care of till they're 18 years of age.
Really? Now who brings the patients
to us?
To you? Or at least their history?
The Shriners see them.
Okay.
We may see a little kid walking on the sidewalk. The other day I saw one walking on the sidewalk a little bit, and
mm-hmm.
I went up to the mother and I says, is this child being treated? And says, no, we can't afford it. Takes an operation. I says, why don't you give me the privilege of getting the information I need, putting my name on the bottom, sending you our clinic. Our clinic will examine you. We have doctors that are just fantastic.
No charge.
Not a dime, but not one dime does this kid. If this kid's 3 years old and they need prosthesis,
mm-hmm.
we take care of those prostheses up through 18 years of age.
Mm. Now, if the audience, I'm not a Shriner.
Right.
Okay. Now, I want the audience to understand that, but I understand that this is a very good, worthy cause. It's for Americans. It's for the people who live in your own neighborhoods. It's not going to a foreign country. How would they? What do you do every year to get money? Do you, is it candy canes?
No. We have nothing like that at all.
Okay, you don't do things like that.
We do not advertise. We do not say it's going to be a certain date for this or nothing at all. This is strictly
donations
by the people. And the reason they do is for the kids.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to say, Shriners are going to be around a long time because we care for those kids.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to see they get the treatment they want. All they have to do is ask us.
Mm-hmm.
Call the temple.
But the thing I'm after here, I understand that. I want the audience to know that they can send you a check.
They can
send it here to the Leisure World
and
Shrine Club.
And we'll take care of it right there, and they will be recognized for our hospital, and they will be recognized in a mighty big way, certificate in the whole way.
And they know where it's going.
They know where it's going.
You bet.
You bet we know where it's going.
I like that.
That's where it's going, every bit of it. Now, I may say,
mm-hmm.
we have a little other thing, just a second here.
Sure.
We have another thing like the transportation fund. We have a little girl living in Riverside right now that got burnt a year ago. She has to go back every other month to Galveston. That's where our big deal is. We fly that kid and her mother
mm-hmm.
to Galveston at no charge. At the present time, in this one little girl, we have $21,000 we've invested in airplane transportation for this girl to get treatment
mm-hmm.
in Galveston.
Mm-hmm.
Burned face,
mm-hmm.
hand, but we're going to whip it.
Good.
We have a doctor that's a lady back there. I would say Dr. K is probably maybe 32, 33 years old, and she's a fabulous, fabulous burned surgeon. Fabulous. Devoted.
Isn't it wonderful?
Devoted. It's just there.
That's just wonderful.
Now, I may sound like I'm proud, but I'm proud. We're just,
no,
I can understand
that. Yeah. I can understand that. And all my life, you know, everyone's heard of the Shriners, and they don't. Everybody has this thing in their head of what they do. Now you're telling us exactly what they do.
Right.
The fun is a small part. The kids are the big part.
We turn no one down that wants to be a Shriner. And the only prerequisite they have to be a Shriner is they belong to the Masonic Lodge.
Mm-hmm.
After they belong to the Masonic Lodge, then they belong to one of the York Riders or Scottish Rite. After they do that, they can become a Shriner. No problem.
You all heard just exactly what to do. Illustrious potentate, I really appreciate you being here tonight.
You know,
clearing up my mind, and while you're doing it for, I'm sure a lot of people, there's a lot of people who do know what it is. I'm sure that they give all the time, but if you have an extra check, I'm sure these people would love to take it. Help the kids out. I thank you so much for tonight.
My pleasure. Thank you, Fred.
You've enlightened me anyway. So thank you.
Maybe it'll help me a little bit, too.
Thank you very much, ladies.